and good friend, Professor Dr. Hany Farid, who is also a senior advisor of CEP and professor at the School of Information and the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Sciences at the University of California, Berkeley. So a fairly unknown university in America. Before this appointment, Professor Farid was the Albert Bradley 1915 third century professor and chair of computer science at Dartmouth, another one of very unknown schools. His research focuses on digital forensics and image analysis and human perception, and he is without a doubt one of the, if not the leading digital forensic specialists on the planet. He received his undergraduate degree in computer science and applied mathematics from the University of Rochester in 1989 and his PhD in computer science from the University of Pennsylvania in 1997. Following a two-year postdoctoral fellowship in brain and cognitive science at MIT, he joined the faculty at Dartmouth in 1999. He is the recipient of the Alfred P. Sloan Fellowship, a John Simpson Guggenheim Fellowship, and a fellow of the National Academy of Inventors. He's also the chief technology officer and co-founder of 4&6 Technology. Hany, the floor is yours. I'm glad that you could join us today.
Thank you so much, Hans. It's good to be here and it's good to be talking about these important issues. I'm gonna take the next 10 minutes. I'm a technologist, I'm not a policy person. I like talking to policy people for the obvious reason that I think it should be informed by a fundamental understanding of the strengths and the limitations of technology. So what I'm gonna talk today about is what does automated decision look like in the year 2020? As you just heard, a lot has changed in the intervening 20 years as the internet has risen and really sort of taken over. And I wanna talk a little bit about what is the state of the art of decision making in today in terms of technology. And when you think about decision making, there's really sort of three categories you can think about: fully manual, fully automatic, and what I'm gonna call hybrid. So let me talk first about manual. So manual is exactly what you think. You have human moderators, and they simply look at, like the way the New York Times does, editorial page, every single article that's published is analyzed. Now, of course, as you already heard in the previous presentation, the internet is very, very large. Just to give you a sense of how large, on YouTube, there are 500 hours of video posted every, this is actually a typo, it should say minute, not hour. 500 hours of video every minute are uploaded to YouTube. On Facebook, there are about 350 million images per day, and on Twitter, about 500 million tweets. That is a phenomenal scale, and it, of course, is also global. The internet knows no boundaries. So given the sheer volume of data that is uploaded every minute of every day of every week and month, the fully manual is probably not a realistic model. So let's think about a fully automatic system. So what would a fully automatic system look like? There's really two broad categories here that I've enumerated. The first is what we call re-upload, and then the second is full-on moderation. So let me describe re-upload first, because in some ways this is the easier and more solved problem. So re-upload says, I have previously identified a piece of content that doesn't belong online because it violates terms of service or it's illegal, or I just don't want it on my platform. And once that has been identified, tools like PhotoDNA and eGLIF, which I've been part of developing, can reach into that content, whether it's an image, a video, or an audio, extract a unique digital signature, and then stop that content from being re-uploaded. This technology has been in wide use for many, many years now. PhotoDNA in the space of child sexual abuse material, eGLIF in the space of counterterrorism material, and the various platforms, the Facebooks, the Twitters, and the YouTubes, use their own re-upload filters to deal with everything from copyright infringement to other violations of terms of service. So this technology is fairly well understood. It's been deployed for almost a decade now, but it only deals with content that has been previously identified. And so now the question is, well, how do I previously identify that content? There's two basic ways. The manual that I just enumerated, again, we have scale problems, but we still have manual reviewers. And the other way is this next category here, which is artificial intelligence, that you have AI systems that simply that implement rules on your platform. And the problem is with those fully automatic systems in the AI category here, is that despite tremendous progress in AI and machine learning and deep learning over the last few years and really decades now, those technologies are simply not capable to do the type of decision-making that we need at a fully automatic scale. And to just help you understand why that is, if I go do, for example, just photo DNA, so that's technology that we developed to stop the redistribution of previously identified child sexual abuse material. The error rate of that technology is somewhere on the order of 1 in 50 to 100 billion. So 50 to 100 billion pieces of content come by before we make a mistake. And so that means even at internet scale, this technology works. There'll be a couple of mistakes a year. Those can be managed with appeals, and we can manage that the same way we manage mistakes in spam filtering. Even the absolute best AI systems today dealing with complex decision-making around content moderation, you're lucky if you can be at 90%. So that means a 1 in 10 error. You are many, many, many orders of magnitude away from the level of accuracy that you need to fully unleash these technologies to work at the scale of the internet. Okay. Now, when will AI get there? I don't know. Some people think Mark Zuckerberg will tell you it's a couple of years. I think that's overly optimistic and slightly naive. I don't think anybody thinks that we are going to go from where AI now is in a few years to virtually perfect. That's not the way the technology development is happening. So what can we do? So I'm an advocate of what we call hybrid approaches, is that we combine all the best of everything that we have. So re-upload filters, there is no reason why we shouldn't be doing this. Once content has been identified, once the Christchurch shooting video in New Zealand has been identified, there is no reason why a human being should have to lay eyes on that video. There's no reason why you need AI for that video. It has been identified. You know that you don't want it on your platform, and we should be able to eliminate it across the board on all mainstream sites. So those filters, there's no question, should be used. They've been used for a long time in a number of spaces. AI has a place, but not in a fully automated system. Its space is as a triage, so that you take, the goal is to take those millions, billions of uploads every minute of every day and filter them down into a more manageable number that then can be manually reviewed. If I can eliminate 90% of material from consideration, that's a huge win for manual operations. Now, do we have enough manpower and woman power to do this? That's an interesting question, but certainly the AI can reduce some of the complexity of the scale of the internet that we are working with. And the last thing we need on top of the re-upload filters, good triage, good manual review, is better policy. We need, as you already heard in the previous presentation, more transparency, more consistency, and more thoughtful policy. Facebook notoriously is a place that allows hate and divisiveness and conspiracy theories that lead to sowing of civil unrest, interference with democracies, health issues around the COVID-19 pandemic. We need to have more thoughtful policies of how we are engaging on social media. And so this is not just a technology issue, but it's also a corporate governance and a corporate responsibility. Now, I will point out, by the way, that there are existence proofs that these solutions work. So for example, Facebook and YouTube ban adult pornography. So perfectly legal speech, and they do it fairly well. They have fairly good technology that finds and removes pornography in a combination of AI and manual review. And why is that, by the way? Why are they so good at removing perfectly protected speech in most parts of the world? It's because it's bad for business. Because advertisers don't want their products alongside the sexually explicit material. And they know that if they don't deal with this problem, their services are going to be littered with adult pornography. And so they're pretty good at it. Here in the US and around the world, after the Digital Copyright Millennial Act passed, the technology companies, after screaming that there was nothing they could do about violations of copyright, developed really good copyright filters. In fact, most of those are in the form of re-upload filters that identify known copyright material and they remove it. Spam, we're actually pretty good at getting rid of spam. Why? It's bad for us, the users. It's bad for the companies. So we have existent proof that we can deal with some pretty harmful content to the services. And now we are simply saying to please, would you, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, TikTok, take those technologies and let's deal with the other problems that we are seeing, from child sexual abuse to terrorism to health risks to interfering with our democracies. I'll also point out, by the way, that when we talk about the internet being big, when Facebook and Google and YouTube say, well, the internet's really big, we don't know how to deal with it, I have another existence proof for you, which is Wikipedia. Wikipedia works fairly well. They have 20 billion visitors a month, 6 million articles, and just about 2 edits every second. So they have built a system that actually is a combination of AI, of human moderation, that does a fairly good job of making sure that there are, that their articles are as accurate as they can be. And it works. There are studies have been shown that these articles on Wikipedia are as good as the classic encyclopedias. So we have existence proofs that we can do content moderation with a combination of existing technologies, new technologies, and changes in policies and priorities. Now, if we're going to talk about content moderation, we also have to talk about the tension here between speech, openness of an internet where we want an open exchange of ideas, and dealing with the harms. And what Mark Zuckerberg will have you believe is that you don't want Facebook being the arbiter of truth. And while that may be true, he's completely missing the point, which is that social media is not passive. Facebook is not simply a place where you can post whatever you want and people view it, and Facebook simply is a host. They are not like the telephone wire. They don't simply allow communication. They decide on a daily basis what you see. The news feed on Facebook, the feed on Twitter, the recommendations on YouTube are algorithmically determined for you with the goal of keeping you on those services for longer. Social media is not passive. On YouTube, 70%, 70, of all watched videos are those videos that are recommended by YouTube. So when Mark Zuckerberg tells you he doesn't want to be the arbiter of truth, you should ask him, well, but you are the arbiter of what is relevant. And I would argue that that is probably a more powerful role than being the arbiter of truth. So social media decides every day what you see, hear, and read. They want to claim that they are not a publisher, but it is simply objectively not true. They are making decisions on a daily basis. They are making decisions to prioritize their bottom line. And if they're making decisions already, what you see, hear, and read, well, then we should simply ask them to prioritize things that are good for us as individuals, societies, and democracies. And then the last thing I'll say on this is that part of the reason we are in the mess today with social media is that social media has figured out that hate and division and outrage sells. People are drawn to divisive content. It is tapping into the worst instincts of human nature. And because the business model of social media is to keep you engaged on the platform for as long as possible, because that's how they extract your data and deliver advertising, their algorithms have learned that what they promote to you, what they recommend on the feed, what they recommend on YouTube, should be the more hateful, the more divisive, and the more outrageous, because that's going to keep you coming back for more. That is an editorial decision, and that is something that can be fixed relatively easy with changing the nature of algorithmic amplification and changing the priorities. I believe that the technologies exist to deal with at-scale content moderation, but they require a combination of technology, human moderation, and changes in policy. And I'll go ahead and stop there, and I'll be happy to take your questions.